Good evening. I'm Jim Whaley. Sometimes on Cinema Showcase, it becomes not only a pleasure, but a privilege and honor to be able to talk with a guest. And tonight is just such an occasion, because my guest is Miss Lillian Gish. I hesitate to use the word legend in talking about so vital, wonderful, and ever youthful person as Miss Gish, but indeed she is a legend in her own time. She is here tonight to talk about her new book, entitled Dorothy and Lillian Gish, which contains over 800 beautiful photographs covering the careers of she and her sister. Tonight, Lillian Gish on Cinema Showcase. Good evening and welcome to tonight's program. And join me in welcoming Lillian Gish. Thank you so much for being here. It's a pleasure.
Thank you for letting me come and talk about my new child.
Well, it is indeed, I must say, as I said in the introduction, a beautiful book, so sumptuously illustrated. Now, you had written your autobiography several years ago, which is a must for every motion picture fan. Why and when did you decide to embark on this new project?
I didn't decide on the other one. The other was Reader's Digest idea. They wanted D.W. Griffith's story told. He's the man that is responsible for America's only art form, which is the film. And they thought I should write a story, and I said I wasn't good enough. I couldn't write a book. Well, for about 6 months, I'd met and talked with them. Finally, one of them said, if you don't tell his story, it will never be told. You're the only one that knows it, and you owe it to him. Well, that did it. I do, and so does everyone who ever made a film or ever looked and enjoyed a film. Mm-hmm. He is, without a doubt, the only man who's given us what we see when we look at a movie today. I think Mr. Walt Disney added the only dimension since then. He gave us animation and beauty in Fantasia. He brought wildlife into our world and mm-hmm. our lives and did so much for children.
That's right.
So these two men we owe a great debt to.
And I'll always think it was one of the most regrettable things of all time, the neglect of D.W. Griffith in his later years.
Yes, they did. That's true. But they paid no attention to Mr. Disney either, you know.
That's true.
And look, Hollywood's gone, Mr. Disney survives. They come from all over the world to see his Disney World in Florida and the other one in California. And his films are still being looked at.
Mm-hmm.
They do attract audiences, and you can't say that about many films today.
That's true. Well, tell me about this project. When did you decide
on this? This book, James Frazier, who's the editor of it, was getting my papers ready to take down to the Library of Congress. They wrote and asked for my papers in 1950. And I said, what papers? And they said, everything but your household bills and accounts. So it took me 18 years to reach a point of vacation. When we had a few days off, I asked Mr. Frazier if he would catalog and get them ready. He went down to the room we have in downstairs in our apartment house and found a great many pictures, which I thought would go to the Library of Congress also, and he wanted to look at them. He looked at 4,000, and he said, this would make a book. And I said, well, make a book. And he put it all out, or many of them, on the dining room table, and called in my agent, and she said, yes, there is a book there. She brought in publishers, and Mr. Charles Scribner, excuse me, he came, bought it, and Mr. MacLean, representing Macmillan in London, came and looked and bought it. And it was published the 16th of October, and today, the 15th of November, it's in its third printing.
That is incredible.
But it's not just a picture book.
Yeah.
It's the history of our century, because we are the first century to leave a living history through the big screen and the little screen. And I think it's a proper thing to have a book with that in, representing two that almost covered the century. Dorothy and I were 4 and 5 years of age when we started working in the theater, and that was the middle of the first decade. So we missed it by 5 years covering the century. And I tell I have 7 decades and give the history of our world mm-hmm. 7 times, very briefly, about that long. It started about that long, and I kept bring it down, like Mark Twain said, if I'd had more time, I would have written a shorter letter. I took more time, I wrote a shorter book. But it explains our history and tales of all these various mediums, radio coming in, and the Nickelodeons coming in, what happened to the theaters, all this happened, then television, and now theater is quite different too. Mm-hmm. And I just closed in a play in August. So I think I can tell the story from backstage, yes. inside, which makes it interesting for people who are, well, anyone interested in fashion, mm-hmm. or photography, or writing, or being an actress. They see 2 lives, beginning as children and never stopping.
Do you suppose it was natural that your sister and yourself went into acting since your mother was an actress?
No, mother didn't want to be an actress. Never was a wish of hers. She was ashamed of it and finished and stopped as soon as she could. We had to do it out of necessity. In those days, well, you could go to the poorhouse, mm-hmm. but pride wouldn't allow you to do that. And mother got a job in the stock company in New York, Proctor Stock Company, and we had to be taken to her dressing room on matinee days at night. The world was safe enough for her to put us in bed and leave us. But we were there playing one day when an actress came in and said she could get a job if I would go along to play the child. And mother sent me out with Aunt Alice and Dorothy the same way in another month. She went out with Aunt Dolores in East Lynn. And next year, mother got a position with all 3 of us.
You made your debut in one of the most interestingly named cities I think I've ever heard. That was it Rising Sun?
Rising Sun, Ohio.
Yes.
I didn't believe it. Oh, somebody dreamed that up. But we were playing in a college in Findlay, Ohio, and we saw a signpost saying 7 miles to Rising Sun. And then I've since had letters from people that remember that performance. And I took my first curtain call sitting on Walter Houston's shoulder. Young to realize what an honor.
It's an auspicious debut, I must say.
Yes.
My goodness. Traveling about as much as you did when you were youngsters, do you think this was valuable for you, or do you look back on it as something negative, going from town to town?
Oh, we thought we were the most privileged people in the world, and we didn't have to stay in one town and go to school like those other poor little girls. We learned our lessons on the spot. If we would go to Gettysburg, mother would take her little history book. We'd go out and learn our history there. We'd go up to Plymouth Rock. If we were in Detroit, we'd be taken through the automobile factories. And down here, we'd go to the cotton fields, mm-hmm. follow through to the dress. Oh, we were privileged. And as a reward for learning our lesson, we were allowed to play a strange game I don't think any other children ever were allowed to do. We could go into the cemeteries and look on the tombstones for the names of our ancestors.
My goodness.
I'm sure mother did it so that we would stay out in the fresh air and learn to play and be on the green grass.
It seems like that would be an invaluable lesson in human nature, to be able to cover the country that way and learn firsthand about people in every area.
And we were in our middle teens when we were sent abroad, so then we could pick up languages.
Yeah.
I've lived about 15 years in Europe, and I find it's the most valuable education one could have, I think.
Before you went into films, you were in a production of Sarah Bernhardt's, weren't you?
Yes, when I was 6 or 7 years of age, only dancing.
Yeah.
Because, of course, I couldn't speak French.
Yeah. Well, how did your first film come about?
We were too lanky. You know how children get to be all arms and legs, and they didn't want us. The leading ladies at that time were very small. In our first play, her first false step, our leading lady, Helen Ray, was 4'10". So we heard that our friend was in the movies, so we went down to see her, and Mr. Griffith offered us something in the film. And we were looking, it was summertime, we were looking for our next play. And we did one picture or two or three. Maybe I worked there at most 2 weeks. And then I went with Belasco in The Good Little Devil. Mm-hmm. And Mr. Griffith took Dorothy west and offered me a job. And I went out and joined them later.
What was your first impression, or do you recall your first impression of D.W. Griffith?
We thought he was Mr. Biograph. That was the name of the company. So we didn't know who he was. We thought he owned it. He acted as if he did, and his voice was very commanding.
Yeah.
He could tell you to do something, and you did it without hesitation. And he had, you've seen pictures and films of General MacArthur. He's the only man I ever saw that looked like him, but he didn't have that deep, resonant baritone voice. And Griffith had studied opera, too, so that when it told anyone, even an animal, to do something, it did it. He could put a little kitten to sleep by saying, "You go to sleep," and that kitten would go to sleep.
In your autobiography, the movies Mr. Griffith and Me, you recount very humorously a meeting with your mother, Mr. Griffith, and you and your sister, where he asked your mother, "Can they act?" And your sister said, "Sir, we are of the legitimate stage."
Yes, we thought acting was reading lines. He said, "That hasn't anything to do with it. I mean, can you act?"
Yeah.
We didn't know what he was talking about. We'd spent 7 years being paid for something that we thought was called acting.
Why did he call one of you red and one of you blue?
He didn't know one from the other. He couldn't tell Dorothy from me, and he had to give quick directions, so he put a blue hair ribbon on me and a red one on Dorothy and called us red and blue.
So that way he could tell.
Quickly.
That's amazing. Film actors at that time, I was very sort of surprised to learn, were really frowned upon by the social elite, weren't they?
Well, so were actors in the theater. We weren't allowed in good hotels. Till, I guess, the teens. Actors were accepted from that time on, as soon as they were able to pay their bills. They would, you know, be stranded in a town and not have any money. So they'd slip out in the night. And, of course, Mother said they earned that. You're never discriminated against unless you do something. Now, you see when you grow up that you don't get something you can't pay for. And it won't happen to you.
Mm-hmm.
You'll change all that.
The first all-star film you recount very well in the book, and that was called Home Sweet Home, I believe, which is, I guess, considered the first all-star film because it had so many of Griffith's great people in it. Would you tell us a little bit about that film?
Well, that was the story of the man who wrote the song, his life, and the effect of his song on different people, short stories, little incidents that happened, and this whole Home Sweet Home song, what it did in affected their lives, as I'm sure films affect people's lives. I've had it told to me so many times what happened to people as a result of seeing certain films.
Mm-hmm. Now, you have toured extensively, and I know you have given talks on films at colleges and universities. How aware are young people really today of films?
My fans are all between 11 and 19. When I was first followed around the streets of New York by children, I thought I was imagining. And then someone would get up courage and say, "Miss Gish, may I have your autograph?" And I said, "But how do you know me?" And they'd say, "Oh, we have your films at home. Papa bought so-and-so. He runs it for us all the time." They buy these films to wean their children away from the violence on television.
Yeah.
And of course, if you run a film over and over, you get to be one of the family. And then we have silent film theaters around the country, I find, by the hundreds, where they run the old films. And the youth, having just discovered them, find them more exciting than the films with talk, and they do hold the story back. Mm-hmm. Words slow things up.
That's right.
You can tell by seeing a thing at a glance what's happening. And you might have to have 20 sentences to describe it.
In fact, Griffith called the silent film the universal language.
Well, he did his first talking picture in 1921, you know, and discarded it long before there were talking pictures.
I didn't know that.
It was called Dream Street, and he ran it in New York at Town Hall. And when I played there a year ago, April, with my Art of Film, a voice came over the telephone, wanted to know if I knew that when that was there, there was a young man that was backstage and up in the projection booth and all around watching how it was being done, and his name was Warner. And I said, which one, do you remember? He said, I think his name was Jack.
That is incredible.
It took them 7 years to get to it. But at that time, from 1915 to 1928, we had the world market all alone. And Griffith, when he did his talking picture, he said, why, not 5% of my audience could understand English. Mm-hmm. Why should I commit suicide and alienate 95%?
That's right.
And now you see we are 10th, 11th, 12th in the world of making pictures. Japan, India, even Taiwan makes more films than we do.
In fact, you mentioned in your book that you felt you were alienating some of your fans by speaking.
Well, I did. Because the book you speak of, the movies Mr. Griffith and Me, has been translated into 14 different languages now. Even Burmese, Assamese, and East Malaysian.
My God.
Languages no one's ever seen in print in our country.
Yeah.
Prentice Hall were deeply impressed. No book of theirs ever went. And it had nothing to do with me. It had to do with things they remembered and were curious about.
If we might, let's talk about Birth of a Nation for just a moment. Do you find this is the one picture that people do seem to be most interested in? Or would it be
Intolerance? No, I would say Way Down East and the ice flow. They ask more about.
I must say the photographs in this book from Way Down East are the most incredible I have ever seen.
Well, they're the working
pictures
with the camera, the crew, and it shows the background of where we were up in Vermont.
That is incredible.
In midwinter, White River Junction. There are two rivers up there, you know. We wanted one river going out in the daytime. Mm. And very often a river will go out at night.
And there was no fake snow in that picture. It was all real.
Oh, you'd know fake snow in a minute. They redid it as a talking picture with Henry Fonda and Rochelle Hudson, I think. It came to New York and had to be taken off after 5 days. Business was so bad. Because you knew the snow wasn't real.
Yeah.
The camera's psychic. You can't fool it. I think that's why we don't get upset with all these automobile chases. We know there's someone else in the car driving. They're not going to risk the lives of their actors doing things like that. But in those days, we did.
Yeah.
We didn't use doubles because we thought the camera would know the difference. And we weren't important. Mm-hmm. Only what was on the screen mattered.
Mm. Getting back to Birth of a Nation, which we started to talk about, actually Griffith had touched on the Civil War in several prior film, but he had always wanted to make his version of the Civil War, hadn't he?
His father was Colonel Roaring Jake Griffith in the Civil War, and I guess he grew up listening to stories of it. And I think his father led a charge in a wagon. He'd been shot off his horse, so someone put him in a wagon, and he led the charge from that. And I believe that's the only time it was done.
Mm.
So, of course, he wanted to tell his father's story, I suppose.
Yeah.
Some of it, I don't know that all of it, but that was the first 12 reel film ever made. That's why it caused such a sensation.
Mm-hmm.
The movie theaters wouldn't run it, you know. They said, no, 12 reel film, that would hurt the audience's eyes, those flickers. And he put it in legitimate theaters and sent out 28 companies with orchestra and sound effects touring the country in legitimate theaters. And they would go in and play to 3 times the population of the towns, because many people had never seen a film until that time. Mm. And it cost $61,000. It took 9 weeks to film, and it made over $100 million. Nothing has ever done anything like that.
They really didn't keep accurate records of how much it made, did they?
Well, because people like Louis B. Mayer and the others that afterwards became what they called movie moguls, mm-hmm. they bought state rights, and that was the beginning of their fortune. They all told me that, or many of them since. Hmm. When I went to work for MGM, I heard Mr. Mayer say, I want to meet the girl who's responsible for my fame and fortune. And I'd never seen the man. I thought, what does he mean? And he said he'd pawned everything he owned to get, I believe, the Massachusetts state rights for The Birth of a Nation. And it made him a fortune, of course.
Yeah, I bet if accurate records had been kept, heaven knows how much...
You couldn't imagine.
Yeah, it would triple The Godfather and Gone with the Wind and everything
else. Oh,
forgive me for even mentioning that film in the same breath, but anyway. One remark I wanted to ask you about, Billy Bitzer, who was Griffith's great cameraman,
yes.
said that when Griffith embarked on Birth of a Nation, his entire attitude about filmmaking seemed to change. In other words, he seemed to really get involved on a scale with which he had not previously. Were you aware of this? He always was involved.
He wrote his stories mainly. We rehearsed them, you know, for days. Mm-hmm. There was only one take of everything. We didn't have the money to have two takes. We couldn't buy the film. They had to be made so cheaply. And The Birth of a Nation only had one take. All those battle scenes, one take. They were all planned so well that they could be put together. He knew exactly what he was doing, and there was never anything written. Nothing in anyone's handwriting except the cutter. He would mm-hmm. come in at the last rehearsals and take down the story so that when the film came through, he would know where it belonged.
Goodness. One of the greatest shots, I suppose, in the film was accidental, almost, and that's the shot with William Freeman. That wasn't planned, was it, the century?
We all had to carry our clothes, mm-hmm. and I was wearing hoop skirts, and all the skirts that covered the hoops, they made them very heavy. And when we left our dressing rooms at 8 o'clock in the morning to work on the lot, we had to take everything with us because there was no time to go back to your dressing room and change your clothes and come back again. They couldn't wait for that. Mm-hmm. You had to go in back of the scenery or someplace and quickly change your clothes. And Mr. Freeman used to help me carry some of the things. And we were taking the scene in the hospital, and he was leaning there on his gun, looking. And Griffith said, Billy, get that face, get that face. And he just took Freeman looking at the love scene between Elsie and the little colonel.
Mm-hmm. And it's one of the most affecting shots in the picture,
really. The biggest laugh in the birth, of course, and worth a great deal of money because we had so few laughs.
Whatever happened to him, do you know?
I was on a float in the New York World's Fair. What I was doing on a float, I can't tell you, but there I was, and someone called my name. I looked down, and there was Freeman. And I said, oh, where have you been all these years? He said, just a minute, I want to show you something. And he came back with a little four-year-old boy, his son, and wanted to show me. And just then, the float went on, and I lost him again. I haven't seen him since.
You know, his name apparently was totally unknown for a while because there are so many books which show that shot, and they say that the unidentified player received great comment, you know.
Yes, well, so he was in the Navy, I think, and I believe stationed out there, and on days off he'd come and work in the films, what they call now moonlighting.
Yeah. Did the censorship, Birth of a Nation caused a lot of turmoil when it played. Did this bother Mr. Griffith?
Oh, he always caused turmoil. They called out the militia here when that was made, and France, when he made The Two Orphans, or The Orphans of the Storm, as we retitled it, they called out the militia there. When he made Broken Blossoms, they objected in England because the prize fighter father that beat me to death was an Englishman. Mm-hmm. Finally, Mr. Griffith said, well, what am I to do? The only villains I can have are us. We realize that we've got some bad men, bad people among us.
Yeah.
Because he was always getting into trouble.
Yeah. But he was justifiably hurt, though, I think, over the accusation that he was against the Negro.
Oh, because they raised him and he loved them.
Yeah.
And they loved him. Any colored people that came to our studio they gravitated around him and loved him. As a proof of it, there is a lady, Madame Sullivan, that's in the berth. Mm-hmm. She had two sons, and they always had work wherever Mr. Griffith was. And when he died, who was sitting outside his room? Not me, not any of his friends. I don't know about his family. Madame was out there during his last days. And I worked in a television with one of the boys. And, oh, they speak so affectionately. They said he was like our father. He looked after us all our lives.
Yeah.
You know, he was so deeply hurt by that. Because if any man was against any kind of prejudice, I think it was Griffith. That's why he did Intolerance.
Mm-hmm.
Think as I think or be damned.
Yeah.
Or man's inhumanity to man. He was a true Christian, and I, as far as I could see, or anyone ever working with him, had no prejudices.
Yeah.
Only, he had to have evil as against good to get drama. And good always won out.
Mm-hmm.
He never allowed, as they do today, evil to be made attractive, particularly for young people.
That, I think, is one of the regrettable aspects of the style of filmmaking today, when, as you say, evil is made so attractive.
Yes, they make it so attractive and teach the young how to use guns.
Mm-hmm.
Recently, we've heard of a 12-year-old child with a little gun shooting another. And I believe on television they show someone putting gasoline on a body, a live person, and burning it. And then soon after, we had it happening in one of our cities. And they compared the two. That's wrong.
It certainly is. He, Griffith was also totally against censorship, wasn't he?
I think all of us Americans are.
Yeah.
I think I liked good taste to come back, beauty to come back. We've lost beauty. And I think there's no relationship that if it's made beautiful that's offensive.
Mm-hmm.
And certainly the human body. Look at the paintings and the statues we have of the nude bodies, how beautiful they are. We should take the old Florentine motto of the 15th century. Well, maybe they were in such trouble.
Uh-huh. That's right.
And what they said was, do what you will, but do it beautifully.
This half hour has indeed just sped by for me. I cannot thank you enough. I want to invite you to come back and talk with us anytime you like. I hope you've enjoyed it.
Thank you, I have indeed. Maybe I've talked too much.
You have.
But I had to talk about my newest child. I think it's something for the family
it is.
For the little children, the older people, any age. It's a conversation piece.
It is a wonderful book, Dorothy and Lillian Gish. And I want to thank you, Miss Lillian Gish, for being here tonight. Thank you.
I thank you for having me.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Good night. Mm-hmm.